I've had two guests come here and tell me that we're in a comfort crisis.
We are seizing moments and opportunities through behavior or substance to distract ourselves from ourselves because we are experiencing discomfort with whatever emotion is coming up. And it's easier to divert to something that will give us a sense of ease and comfort or distraction than to sit with that sense of dis-ease.
They say that we're kind of optimizing our way away from comfort in every sense of the word. We're like, you know, we live in these sort of room temperature rooms where we can go on a piece of glass and get someone to bring us our food in a metal car right to our doorstep. And and in fact, discomfort and pressure is where our growth, our health, and all of these things, our fulfillment in many cases comes from. Doing an ultra endurance race is for me, you know, one of the epitomes of pressure and discomfort and sitting with that and accepting it. Do you believe that more of us should be making ourselves uncomfortable in that context more often and that there's tremendous value in that? I think about it when I hear like, fucking hell, Steve, why don't I get on my bike and just ride and just see and push myself, see where I can take it.
100%. You don't grow unless you go out of your comfort zone. And that's in every facet of your life. If you want to become smarter, you have to read books or go to school. Like, that's not always comfortable. There's a million different varieties of this. But yes, we are in a culture that prioritizes comfort and luxury, and it's all about making our lives easier. Ironically, what makes us happy is putting ourselves in difficult situations, not so difficult that they capsize our lives, but difficult enough that we're testing ourselves. And we're grappling with obstacles and we're overcoming them. And on the other side, we feel a boost in self-esteem. We feel more ourselves. We feel more alive. And we experience growth and connection with self and connection with other people. This is the stuff of life. And yet, it is not the way that society is constructed. We have to go out of our way now. We have to seek it used to be this was everyday life just to survive, right? And now we actually have to pay money and travel to places to have these experiences. What's so amazing is that, you know, when I started doing these ultra races, they're all very kind of like low key, under the radar. There's not a lot of media attention on them. You know, it's a subculture that has been around for a while, but in the last decade, we've seen an explosion in interests in like doing 100-mile races. Like, there's lotteries now to get into a race where you have to run 100 miles. Like, if you told somebody in 1800 that this was going to be the case, they would think you were insane, right? So what does that say? It tells us that we feel nourished by doing hard things, that we are extracting value from those experiences that we don't get in the mundanity of our everyday lives. And yes, we have to consciously extract ourselves from the comforts of our environments and put ourselves in those positions. But the good news is there's lots of those things right now. It's insane how many marathons, the London Marathon was the other, like how many thousands of people ran it. And then there's a Spartan race, and there's just a million of these things now that didn't used to exist because the human spirit needs it, it demands it. And we have too long deprived ourselves of these types of scenarios. That doesn't mean that you want to be unsafe or put yourself in peril, but I just don't see any other way or any other path towards becoming the better version of yourself without placing yourself in scenarios in which you're tested. Because succeed or fail, you have an experience that's going to teach you more about who you are, what your limitations are, and what your capabilities are.
The popularity of these endurance races and even things like ice plunge pools and stuff.
Sure.
All of these things that make us feel really uncomfortable. Again, it reminded me of what I said earlier about because there's been a real rise in sort of social media and the digital screens and all of these things. Now, people are looking for places for community. So bowling alleys and in real life events have increased. And in the same way, because we've optimized our lives to be more comfortable and easy, now there's a booming industry around things that make us feel uncomfortable. You said, I didn't get into ultra endurance sports to win races, beat others, or stand atop a podium. I got into it because it's the perfect template for self-discovery. Mm. What did you discover about yourself? And also, I think it's probably important to say to people, you're really, really good at this ultra endurance stuff. Like, we haven't quite gone through your CV yet, but I mean, I've got a list of accolades that you've achieved, and you're one of the best at this. So I think that's worth saying before we proceed.
Yeah, thank you for that. I mean, I've learned so much. The amazing thing about endurance athletics is you have to spend a lot of time with an elevated heart rate that's not so uncomfortable that you can't perpetuate it for hours and hours and hours, but is just uncomfortable enough where you're sitting in that discomfort and you have to develop a tolerance for that. So what it does is it teaches you how to suffer, how to manage pain, but also how to be with yourself. Like, when I was training for these races, I would go out like all day alone, and it's just you, your breath, and your mind. And at that time, I really was trying to figure out, like, I can't be this lawyer anymore. Like, what am I gonna do? Like, all I know is I really like doing this. This is not a career path. This is not, I'm not gonna support four kids doing this thing that I love. But it is bringing so much value to me that I just know I wanna keep doing it. And I'm going to pay attention and pull whatever threads show up. And what I learned through this journey of training, most importantly, the training, the races are just, you know, a demonstration of what you put into getting to that point, was on a surface level, as an athlete, I had a lot more to say than I ever believed that I could. I was able to do things I never would have thought possible, and do it in my 40s, which is an age where people think you're way past your prime. So that was huge. And like I said earlier, that opened up the possibility of tapping into potential in other areas of my life. But I also learned that when you cultivate and nourish that thing that is bringing you joy, and you pay attention to the subtle voices that are telling you this feels right, when you commit to that completely, that will set you on a journey that will lead you to a place you can't possibly imagine. When I put on the running shoes for the first time and just thought, I love doing this, could I have imagined that I'd be sitting across from you right now having a conversation? It's ridiculous. It's preposterous. So what I learned was the power of connecting with the heart, as somebody like yourself who lives in their mind and prides themselves on their intellect and their analytic abilities, understanding the limitations of that and finding a way to really pay attention to those kind of more ephemeral, ethereal messages that one will receive when you're really quiet, you're really honest with yourself, and you're committed to taking actions that are in alignment with that in a way that maybe you never prioritized before. And that has been a path that I've blazed for many years at this point that has caused suffering and hardship, but also beautiful creative offerings and, you know, a life that I could have never imagined for myself.
If you love the Diary of a CEO brand and you watch this channel, please do me a huge favor. Become part of the 15% of the viewers on this channel that have hit the subscribe button. It helps us tremendously, and the bigger the channel gets, the bigger the guests.